It's a great privilege to be delivering the 11th annual lecture of the Godrej Archives. I had a wonderful visit yesterday to the archives and saw some of its prize exhibits. Like any middle-class Indian, I grew up with Godrej. And like any middle-class Indian boy, I wasn't allowed to peep into the Godrej in our house because my mother had the keys and it was forbidden. But beyond that, as a professional historian, I find, while reflecting on how I should begin this talk, that I've had odd encounters with the Godrejes. I started as an environmental historian, and for many years I worked in the field of environmental history and environmental conservation, and of course Godrej played a very important role in the conservation movement in India. Many years ago, before I met Firoza, I've known Firoza for about 8 or 10 years, but well before that, I met Mr. Soli Godrej one evening on a darkened terrace in Bombay after some book event. And it will not surprise those of you who knew Mr. Soli Godrej that we had an argument. And it should not surprise those of you who know me also that we had an argument. But it was, I hope, fully productive, and each of us changed our minds a little bit. So that was when I was an environmental historian. Then I began to write India After Gandhi, which I'll talk a little bit about India After Gandhi later on in my talk. But when I began to write contemporary history, of course, perhaps the chapter I most enjoyed writing was the chapter on our first election. And the heroes of the first election were three heroes, I should say. Jawaharlal Nehru, who was doggedly insistent against both the RSS and the communists that India was fit for parliamentary democracy based on universal adult franchise. Hero number one. Hero number two, Sukumar Sen, the mathematician who was our chief election commissioner. And hero number three, the Godrej ballot box. So, and now I am writing a biography of Gandhi, and I find Godrej has stalked me again. Because as I reach the year 1920-21 and Lokmanya Tilak dies, almost, about 85 years ago, as we speak, Gandhi starts a Tilak Swaraj Fund. Tilak Swaraj Fund, and the major contributor among the Mumbaikers of those days was an Ardeshir Godrej. So for these personal reasons, apart from the professional reasons, I'm delighted and honored to be speaking here today on the challenge of contemporary history. There are several challenges that the historian of the recent past faces. So I'll enumerate these challenges, then I'll talk about how one can try and overcome these challenges, then I'll say a little bit about how in the writing of India After Gandhi, I myself tried to confront these challenges, not always successfully. The peculiar paradox of contemporary history is that we live with the consequences of decisions taken by politicians in the recent past. So in 2015, we are living with the consequences of decisions taken by Indira Gandhi, Manmohan Singh, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, state chief ministers. So in Karnataka, the Bangalore I live and work in is shaped for good and for ill by the actions of Ramkrishna Hegde, S. Bangarappa, and so on and so forth. And because we live with the consequences of decisions taken by politicians, at least those of us who have opinions always presume that an alternate politician, preferably modeled on oneself, could have done better. I have been speaking, not recently, but when I was writing India After Gandhi and afterwards, I must have spoken about Jawaharlal Nehru to about 50 different audiences all over India. And Jawaharlal Nehru was the hero of his age, who's become the outcast of ours. And as I spoke on Nehru to Rotary clubs, to business organizations, to students groups, to NGOs, everywhere I found in the audience someone who could have been a better prime minister than Nehru. So I encountered people who could have solved the Kashmir problem. I encountered people who would have given China a bloody nose on the battlefield, who would have brought about 10% growth from the 1950s, and so on and so forth. Well, this is also true of Indira Gandhi. And dare I say it, it will also be true of Narendra Modi. 10 years from now, you'll find people who will say that they could have run the country far better than Narendra Modi did. Now, the farther back we go in the past, the less of a problem this is for a historian. So if I'm writing about the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, I'm writing for an audience, such as the people in this room, who have preformed opinions. They think what happened, they know what happened. But if I was writing about Ashoka or Akbar, you know, you'll be writing for a readership with a less prejudiced mind, a more open mind. In the case of contemporary history, that is the history of the relatively recent past, the reader is also a citizen with his or her strong political, ideological, cultural preferences. The farther back you go, the less of a problem it is for a historian. Mr. Singh mentioned, that's the lack of density of sources. Government records are often closed. So are many private papers of individuals. Often there are not many memoirs. And as someone who is a historian of contemporary India and has to read a lot of memoirs, as part of his trade, memoirs written by retired businessmen, recently retired businessmen, recently retired politicians, civil servants, policemen, I can tell you that the typical features of a memoir written by a public figure in India are: the memoir is sometimes scandalous, sometimes name-dropping, sometimes self-serving, and often all three. So, when it comes to the contemporary, Peter, there are these problems. Government records are closed, private papers are not available. And this is, again, a generic problem. It's not just one you face in India alone, but in India particularly more so, because people are careless about records in general. Often they're paranoid about what scholars can make about them. You know, the papers of Indira Gandhi are closed, will probably be closed forever. I don't know whether Atal Bihari Vajpayee kept any papers, but the family was not going to give me access to it, or not give anyone else access to it either. So that's the second challenge: a lack of density of source materials compared to 50 or 100 or 150 years ago. The third challenge is one peculiar to India. And I should say a little bit about this, because all of you who studied at Indian universities would have encountered this challenge without really having internalized it. And this is as follows. The third challenge to the contemporary historian, one peculiar to India, not found in England or the United States or Germany or France, is the arbitrary date on which we are told history ends. When the clock struck midnight on 14, 15 August 1947, history ended and political science began. Now, this sort of arbitrary date on which history ended is one reason why we know so much about colonialism and nationalism. The real growth area of writing in Indian history, in which outstanding works of scholarship have been done by dozens of historians across the ideological spectrum in India and abroad, men and women, young and middle-aged and old, the growth area is between Plassey and partition, from 1757 to 1947. And there are extraordinarily rich debates on this period: religious history, cultural history, social history, political history, legislative history, sporting history, and so on and so forth. After 1947, however, the sociologists and political scientists take over. And the works of history by historians properly so-called, that use richly detailed archival research, that analyze the post-47 period systematically and thoroughly on the basis of the historian's craft, the works by contemporary historians on the post-47 period can be counted the finger of quality, can be counted the fingers of two hands. I can name some of them in the discussion if you want, but this is really a striking and in some ways depressing paradox. Indian historians are first rate. They shape not just Indian debates, but global debates. I mean, they're very productive, very insightful, have worked in a wide range of issues, but mostly from Plassey to partition. In recent years, there's been a vigorous movement by historians of ancient and medieval India to focus on the work before the British came. this outstanding work by scholars such as Sanjay Subramaniam, Muzaffar Alam, Nainjot Lahiri, Upinder Singh, Seema Alvi, people of my generation in their 50s and 40s and 50s, who argue that really we have to get over this obsession with colonialism and nationalism and look at what happened in India before. Now, I think there needs to be a similar movement that says that we have to overcome this obsession with colonialism and nationalism by also pushing it forward. And really, that's the burden of my lecture today, that arguing that the history of the 50s and the 60s and 70s, the decades in which this nation was shaped, is absolutely crucial, and yet is so desperately underexplored, understudied. And I'm going to give you some examples of the gaps in our historical understanding of post-47 India. Now, if you take the two concepts that define Indian politics, these two concepts will be caste and elections, right? Social life and political life. Caste, they're the two kind of master categories of Indian social and political discourse, caste and elections. And they've been operative since 1947. I mean, in 1952, we held the first elections, which I've talked about, which were described as the greatest gamble in history, because never before had a country so desperately poor, so divided, largely illiterate, actually gone ahead with universal land and franchise. But despite many predictions that we wouldn't carry it off, we've carried it all through. Likewise, caste. I mean, some modernists like Nehru believed that caste would disappear after economic development and independence. But this didn't really happen. And caste had remained fundamental to our social consciousness, to political articulation, mobilization at the time of elections, and so on. And you have first-rate studies of both caste and elections synchronically at a moment in time. So political scientists have studied every single election from 52, 57, 62, 67, and so on. Anthropologists have done fieldwork exploring the dynamics of caste and caste conflict in different parts of India in the 50s, in the 60s, in the 70s, in the 80s, in the 90s. So you have synchronic studies, because anthropologists do fieldwork at a particular point of time. Political scientists study one election, but we don't have diachronic studies across time. We don't have a single book on how the caste system has evolved, devolved, unevolved since 1947. We don't have a single book that can provide us a social history of this extraordinary tamasha called the Indian election. So that's, just to give you an example, I'm just giving you some examples of the gaps in our historical understanding. You would expect that the scholarly community in India would, you know, pick up on some of these gaps. A second major deficiency in our historical understanding is that there are no critical analytical biographies of many key figures in our modern history. So you have some books on the great national leaders. So you have S. Gopal on Jawaharlal Nehru. You have Rajmohan Gandhi on Vallabhai Patel. You have Rajmohan Gandhi again on C. Rajagopalachari. You have books on Ambedkar that vary in quality. And still, Dharanjay Keel's book, in terms of pure documentation, is probably the best. You would expect that when you have figures as colossal as Nehru and Patel and Ambedkar and Rajaji, that you would have not just one book, but 5 or 10 or 15 or 20. That's what you would have of De Gaulle. There's not just one biography of De Gaulle. There are 30 or 40 or 50. You know, exploring different dimensions, building on new materials, rebutting earlier arguments. But at least you have something on Nehru, something on Patel, something on Ambedkar, something on Rajaji as a kind of benchline, something on Indira Gandhi, national figures. But you have no biographies of what we, in our curious way, call provincial leaders. Think of a man like Sheikh Abdullah. Sheikh Abdullah influenced and shaped the history of Kashmir, India, and Pakistan. There is no serious historical work on Sheikh Abdullah. Think of a person like E.M.S. Nambudripad. And when we talk about our provinces, we should remember that our provinces are the size of a large European country. Now, Maharashtra is the size of France or Germany. And we have some journalistic books on Y.B. Chavan, but not as or Morarji Desai. Colossal figures in the sense that, like De Gaulle, they shaped the life, the culture, the politics, the institutional development of 30 or 40 or 50 million people. or some incredibly fascinating characters in our post-independence history. The Naga rebel Angami Zapu Fizo, there is no book on him. On the charismatic, maverick, complicated Sikh leader Master Tara Singh, there is no book on him. So these are really major gaps in our historical understanding. These are people who had a colossal impact on our modern history. And we don't have a single biography on them. Move to figures in literature or the arts. There is no book on Ravi Shankar, except his autobiography. Each one of our states is distinct and unique in its cultural profile. I'm speaking in Maharashtra. So if you think of a person like Acharya P.K. Atreya and the kind of multi-dimensional impact he had on the life of Maharashtra in the 50s and 60s and 70s. And just as a personal aside, last year, when the great and controversial Kannada writer U.R. Anantamurthy died, I went for the funeral. And later that day, I was meeting Kumar Ketkar, a very widely respected Marathi journalist and writer. And Anantamurthy's funeral was an extraordinary event. You know, he was draped in the tricolor. Opposite him were singers singing Kannada folk songs. And there was a line of us, 12,000 or 15,000 people in all, trooping up to see him. And I asked Kumar, I hadn't seen something remotely like that. And in fact, I should say about why that interested me was a year before Anantamurthy died, he celebrated his 80th birthday. And I went for it. And then I wrote a tribute to him when he was still alive in the Telegraph, where I said, Anantamurthy, he's a larger than life controversial figure. When he dies, his death will be mourned in every district in Karnataka. On the other hand, I said, when an English writer like me dies, at the most will be mourned in the bar of the India International Center. So I'd written this a year before Anantamurthy died, and this actually happened. And so Kumar Ketkar was there in Bangalore that week, and I was chatting to him. And I said, Kumar, he said, the last time it happened in Maharashtra was when P.K. Atre died. I got up at 5 a.m., and I had to go for the funeral. A person even greater than Anantamurthy was the colossal Shivaram Karant, whom I once recklessly described in a Calcutta newspaper as the Kannada Tagore. Of course, I took the precaution of not going to Calcutta for a year after that. Now, where could he even get a halfway decent? He was an extraordinary figure. He revived Yakshagana, he pioneered the modern Kannada novel, he was the first great environmentalist of South India, he worked on gender reform. He was just an amazing chap. And you can't even find a decent essay on him for you to understand the impact he had. So there are really no biographies of political leaders, of musicians, writers, artists. And they actually aren't even, with due respect, I should say, serious, scholarly, independent biographies of business leaders. Those that exist tend to be hagiographies. I'd be happy to give examples if you want, but maybe you don't want them. There could be one exception, which is Medha Malik Kudasia's book on J.D. Birla, would probably be in the field of business history, would be the one book by a scholar that is not a deferential biography of a business leader. So there are no studies of caste in elections. There are no critical, analytical biographies of key figures in politics, culture, society, literature, music, business, sport. No histories of states, each as big as a large European country. No really good histories of policy. I can't think of... It's changing now a little bit in the realm of foreign policy. We now have, for the first time, a high-quality strategic and military historian. His name is Srinath Raghavan. He got the Infosys Prize last year. And he's our first serious scholar of post-independence foreign policy and military history. But it's taken so long to get a scholar of that kind. We now have a young man doing a PhD. I won't name him because that will put the curse on him. Now doing a PhD on the evolution of economic policy from the 1950s. And it'll be the first serious study of economic history post-independence. You've had an outstanding contemporary of mine speak in this series, Tirthankar Ray, who's the acknowledged master of the economic history of British India. But we've had to wait a very, very long time for someone to come along to do a comparable study of the post-50s period. So at these, I would say, are really gaps peculiar to India among the large democracies. Let me repeat a point I've already made once or twice. There is no shortage of first-rate historians working on India, in India or overseas. Absolutely not. But they just don't, very few of them, till very recently, work on contemporary history. In other countries, you don't have this artificial divide where history ends in 1947. History doesn't end with the Second World War in the United States. So you have outstanding and richly researched histories of the Vietnam War, multiple histories, of McCarthyism, of the development of the welfare state, of political and intellectual life. You know, say, there's nothing on P.K. Atre or on Shivaram Karant, but you can read great books on Sartre and Camus and how they shape French intellectual culture, for example. So this is a peculiarly Indian gap. And it's surprising for two reasons. One, that we do have a large and vigorous and highly cultivated traditional historical scholarship on other periods. And the second reason is something, you know, I've always maintained, that India is the most interesting country in the world. Also often the most exasperating, but that's a different question. Now, such a complex, interesting country, undergoing multiple revolutions, and why aren't historians, political scientists are writing about it, anthropologists are writing about it, journalists are writing about it, filmmakers are making great films, playwrights are making fabulous productions, but the historians have come rather late to the party. Now, having sketched out the challenges to contemporary history, let me say a little bit about how I got interested in writing contemporary history myself. Now, I myself was trained in this belief that, you know, after 47 is sociology and before 47 is history. And it was really a commission by a visionary publisher, a man called Peter Strauss, who contacted me in 1997. He read something I'd written. He then ran Picador in the UK. He came to Bangalore. We met. And he said, why don't you write a history of post-independent India? I said, what? He said, well, you've just completed 50 years. Enough time to look back. Your country is incredibly interesting. No one expected it to survive. It's now growing economically. Its global footprint is going to increase. You just write a history of independent India. So it was, I would never have thought of it. And then he rang me up a month later and said, what do you think? I said, I'm still thinking. He said, write me a proposal. So I wrote him a proposal. And then I wrote the book, commissioned in 1997, came in 2007. For a long time, in my computer, whatever I wrote, the notes I collected, the chapters I drafted, were classified under a folder which I named Mythical History Book, because I didn't really think I would write it. It's still there in my computer, those of you who want to come and see it all, by the way. So, I'm deeply, deeply grateful to Peter Strauss that it was a visionary publisher. I mean, you would, I suppose, in business argot, call him a venture capitalist, you know, who identified some chap and said, go run with this idea. But he was a great publishing venture capitalist who allowed me to write India After Gandhi, which was, without question, the most complicated, exciting, interesting, intellectual challenge I will ever face. And I was also very lucky, not only in finding Peter Strauss to give me the idea, but at being at a time of life, at a period in my life, where I could at least try and execute it. If it had come 10 years earlier, I'd have been too young and too inexperienced. If it had come 10 years later, I'd have been too old and too tired. I can't do it now. I mean, the energy it took me to write India After Gandhi, ab mere se nahi hoga. Because the first challenge I faced was that there were very few secondary sources. Now, around the time I was researching India After Gandhi, a historian who is now deceased, whose work some of you will know, called Tony Judt, who was a British historian who settled in the US, wrote a fat book called Postwar, which is the history of Europe since 1947. It's a first-rate book, but large chunks of it are based on a superb, crisp, sophisticated, elegantly conveyed synthesis of existing works. So what he did, I mean, he knew the languages. So what he did was to take 100 books on France, 20 on Poland, 50 on Germany, 60 on the UK and then write a synthetic history of post 47 India. But for me, that was not possible. You know, you would do a similar thing on America, a little bit of primary research, but if you were to write a history of the whole of America or the whole of Europe, which is what I was doing, the whole of India, for a large period of time, 60 years, in America or in Britain or in France or in Germany, you could rely on somebody having done the groundwork, written a history of religion, of language, of gender, of economic policy, of foreign policy, having written, in the case of America, stuff on the South and the civil rights movement, on the North and economic development, on migration and so on, and then built on that. And where there were a few gaps, done some research yourself, but you could have gone to a great American library, and then it was up to your synthetic and analytical skills to carry it off. That's what Tony Judd did with post-war. That's also a very fine American historian called James Patterson did with a book called Grand Expectations, which is a magisterial history of America from 1945 till the 1990s. But I couldn't do this. Firstly, I live in Bangalore, which people call it the knowledge capital of the world or of India, but it doesn't have a single decent library. So there was nowhere I could order 500 books, even if those existed. So I had to find out the facts for myself. I had to do the original research. The government papers were closed. But fortunately, the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library had some 500 collections of private papers of individuals and also of institutions. So there were chunks of Nehru's papers, Rajaji's papers, Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, some of the socialists, the papers of the Congress. It also had a very large run of journals and newspapers, which often are a handy substitute for lack of access to government records, because the newspapers are giving you, you know, direct accounts of what is happening. So a lot of time was spent on the research, because I had to dig in primary materials, and I had to, you know, abandon my family for months and months at a time and go to Delhi, where most of the stuff was. There were some in England also. And dig deeper and deeper and deeper and try and construct a basic narrative for myself. There were some primary sources, also, secondary sources also available. Then a great deal of effort went into the conceptualizing of the book, because it's all of India. I mean, how do you break it up? I say in the preface to India After Gandhi that the only thing I know about the reader of this book, that he or she will complain that there's too much of this or too little on this. Why not more on Adivasis? Why so little on cricket? One of the common complaints I met because of the fact that I'm known as someone who deeply loves cricket was that the chapter called The People's Entertainment has 3 pages on cricket and 15 on film. And of course, films are at least 5 times as important as cricket in the imagination of modern India. So that was a historian's choice. I don't watch film, I watch cricket, but that was not my, it was based on what I thought as a historian. Now, those who know me from my newspaper writings know that I'm a person of passionate opinions. But when I wrote India After Gandhi, I said, I must write it explicitly as a non-ideological history. I was seeking to understand and interpret, not to judge. I repeat this. I was seeking to understand and interpret, not to judge. And I was guided by the maxim of a great 19th century Cambridge historian, F.W. Maitland, who said, that which is now in the past was once in the future. That which is now in the past was once in the future. We think, those of us of my age, think we know all about the 1970s. But the person in the 1950s, for him, that was the future. That was the maxim that kind of guided me. And in the course of my research, guided by the maxim that that which is now in the past was once in the future, trying as hard as I could, obviously not with complete success, but as hard as I could to write a work driven by the narrative, the stories, the new materials, not by my prejudices or my beliefs, I found that several aspects of the conventional wisdom were really myths. What people were talking about I wrote this book between 1997 and 2007. So the conversations about our recent past, the conversations about the history of independent India, that were taking place in drawing rooms, in the internet, on television, several fundamental postulates of this conversation, several aspects of the conventional common sense were really myths. First, that Nehru and Patel were vicious and implacable rivals. This is completely false and untrue. Of course, they had differences, like brother and sister, husband and wife. But in that crucial period between Gandhi's death and Patel's death, from January 1948 to December 1950, they buried their differences in the interests of a partnership that together created the foundations of a united and democratic India. So that's the first myth, that whatever their personal differences, that it actually informed their policies, not at all. Second, that the command economy, that India's decision to adopt a state-centered model of economic growth was completely a creation of Nehru's mind, was also a myth. Nehru was merely reflecting the consensus of the time. There's a document published in 1946 called the Bombay Plan. Its signatories were J.R.D. Tata, G.D. Birla, A.D. Shroff, John Mathai, Kasturbai Lalbhai, Purushottam Das Thakur Das. And they all wanted strong state control. The industrialists of the time said, we lack the capacity, the technology, the resources to invest in steel, in highways, in dams, in just give us some consumer goods and you do the rest. And everyone at that time believed that a strong state intervention was crucial for economic development, partly because the war had just been won by the Soviet Union, which of course was the paradigm case of state-centered industrial development. The second five-year plan, which is kind of the locus classicus of the mixed economy model, was sent to 24 professional economists. 23 accepted its basic postulates. One man disagreed. He was a far-sighted pioneer. His name was B.R. Shenoy. He said we should give more emphasis to private enterprise. But when one person is against 23, you can see what the conventional wisdom is. So Nehru was merely reflecting the conventional wisdom. A third conclusion of my book was that the Kashmir question is really one of alternate national creation myths. It's like a deeply complex dispute embedded in the rival and alternate national creation myths of India and Pakistan. The possession of Kashmir is central to the idea of Pakistan. The possession of Kashmir is central to the idea of India, and that's how they clashed. It's too complex, and it remains too complex to be solved by one man, whether that man be called Narendra Modi or Jawaharlal Nehru. You know, when my book was published, there was an interview in Tehelka magazine, which took something I'd said and made it the headline. And the headline was, Guha says, India's case on Kashmir, constitutionally, India's case on Kashmir is not foolproof. India's case on Kashmir is not constitutionally foolproof. Reading this headline, Dawn newspaper in Pakistan wrote a report saying, Indian historian says India has no case on Kashmir. Whereas actually my book argued that Pakistan's case on Kashmir is also not constitutionally foolproof. So it's a very complex problem relating to the absolute centrality of the possession of Kashmir to the creation myth of Pakistan and India. The K in Pakistan is Kashmir. And of course, India feels it would be incomplete without possession of Kashmir. A fourth interesting aspect of my research, and there are many, many such, I'm sharing you a few, to tell you how, when you write about contemporary history with open eyes, with an idea to what the sources will tell you, not what your preformed opinions, how they guide you, you'll come in, you'll continually surprise yourself as to what you discover. Well, the fourth, I would say, things that struck me and surprised me while writing this book was that Kashmir was not, the other day I was speaking about Kashmir in Bangalore, and I quoted a remark written by Vallabhbhai Patel to G.D. Birla. This is 1949, and Birla was traveling in the United States, and Patel is writing to him about domestic affairs, and he said, Kashmir is giving us, meaning the Indian establishment, Kashmir is giving us a severe headache. And I said in the course of my talk, it's given us a severe headache since then. Right. But actually, Nagaland was giving us a severe headache even before 1947. You know, by us, if I was to include myself in the Indian establishment. So the Nagaland issue was with us from before Kashmir. The Nagas have striven for an independent state from before the Kashmiris did, from 46, in fact. And it's been as much of a complex problem, not treated with the same lack of understanding, the lack of compassion by the Indian state as Kashmir. And it's gone on and on and on, but it's hardly covered in the Indian press and written about by Indian historians. It's not on the front page, but the question this throws up are very similar to the questions Kashmir throws up, the Naga question. How do you reconcile, religious, linguistic, cultural diversity in a unified national state? So, these are some of the conclusions I reached while writing India After Gandhi. And let's end with one last one. I was writing this book in the early 2000s, at a time when people were talking about India becoming a global superpower. That's when I was writing this book. But while I was researching the book, I found that for most of its history, India was not even expected to survive. Through the 50s, through the 60s, through the 70s, through the 80s, right up till the demolition of the Babri Masjid in 1992, many observers, some Indian, more foreign, were writing premature obituaries for India. It would go the way of Pakistan, come under military rule. It would go the way of sub-Saharan Africa, be subject to mass famine and starvation. It would go the way of Yugoslavia, be broken up into 20 parts. And I thought this very puzzling. Here we are saying we're going to become a superpower. And all this while, you know, for most of our history, people are saying we won't survive. And actually, that made skeptical of the claim that India was about to join the superpowers of the world. And I wrote about it from 2007-8 onwards. And I was skeptical in part because I'd seen earlier observers write alternate kind of scenarios, which kind of manifestly failed. So I want to end by saying that we really need much more work on contemporary history. You know, India After Gandhi is a one-volume analysis of the whole of the country. I mean, each of its chapters should be a book. We don't have a single book on the integration of the princely states, on the most complex and difficult challenges a new nation state has ever faced. The only account that exists was written by V.P. Menon as a participant observer in 1956. You know, we don't have histories of our states. I mean, how can you imagine, if you just look at the extraordinary history of Bengal or Maharashtra from the 50s and the 60s and 70s and 80s and 90s, think of its rich and nuanced, varied dimensions. I mean, there was a late Marathi historian, Y.D. Phatke, who wrote on this, but his work, unfortunately, has not been adequately translated in English. There's so many aspects of our post-independence history that are waiting to be researched and written about. The Republic of India is, without question, the most ambitious, the most recklessly ambitious, as well as ambitiously reckless political experiment in human history. We need to be much more better informed. Our historians are letting us down. This is changing with younger scholars. I mentioned Srinath Raghavan's book. There's a young journalist called Harish Damodaran who's written a first-rate book called India's New Capitalists, which is about the deepening of the Indian business class. Joya Chatterjee, a historian at Cambridge, has written first-rate stuff on the settlement of refugees in Bengal. So there is some work coming up, but I think it needs to be much more. My first mentor, a wise old civil servant called C.S. Venkatachar, always told me, all history is interim history. When I wrote my first book more than 25 years ago, he told me, he said, I meant to present it to him, he said, all history is interim history. Every work of history is there to be superseded by a better historian, a more able historian, or a historian able to access sources you are not. And never have I been more conscious of this fact, that all history is interim history, when writing India After Gandhi. My interpretations will and have been questioned. So has my choice of what I've included and what I've excluded. People have said I've written too few pages on tribals, too few pages on film, there's nothing on architecture and art. And I will count myself fortunate if those gaps, omissions, mistakes, misconceptions, misinterpretations will provoke better studies on those subjects. All I can hope is that the challenge of contemporary history is taken up by older scholars, younger scholars, scholars of different temperaments and persuasions than myself, scholars of greater analytical and literary gifts than myself. For I firmly believe that contemporary history is really the growth area of the future. There is so much to find out, so many stories to tell. Thank you.